There's, as you all know, Corey, there's a little bit of a delay on for when you start.
Yes.
So the idea of hitting the live button and just going live is...
Yes. If you do that thing where I stare soulfully at the camera for 10 seconds in order to... Yes, exactly.
Do it live.
All right, we should be theoretically on both Twitch and YouTube now. Let me make sure I get that screen going, and then I will let you go. Yes. And yes, on Twitch.
Hi, I'm Chris Pearson. I'm the lead world builder on LOTRO, and we're here chatting today with Michael Drought, professor of English at Wheaton College and all around Tolkien nut, and Corey Olson, who's the Tolkien professor.
That's right.
At the Mythgard Institute.
Yeah.
It's been a while since we've done one of these. We haven't really been up to much here at LOTRO in the past year and a half or anything, aside from building the entirety of Minas Tirith and the Battle of Pelennor Fields and other things that I'm probably not at liberty to talk about right now.
Right.
But I wanted to know if you guys had, what you guys have been up to in LOTRO in the intervening time.
Well, I've been doing my weekly Twitch stream, where I've taken my Hobbit Grifflet, whom I started at level one. We started at the beginning of the epic quest line, and I've been streaming his way all the way through. He's gotten now to Lorien. He's just recently met Haldir, and then immediately got sent back to Moria.
Uh-huh.
Did
you manage to get shot many times trying to walk into Lorien?
I didn't. Actually, the elves aren't nearly as aggressive as they used to be in guarding the frontier of Lorien. Yeah. They've mellowed over time, is what I understand. But yeah. So it was good. So that's been fun. So I recently finally got a war steed for the first time, which was especially comical because my computer was malfunctioning on the day that I got it. I was streaming it, and my computer was malfunctioning on the day that I got it. So the lag was horrible.
Mm-hmm.
So trying to learn how to navigate a war steed with terrible lag was
crashed into everything.
Oh man, it was just but fortunately it was comic relief for
pinball machine.
Yeah, exactly. It was kind of sad. But anyway, I've been excited to be exploring Rohan at last. I have gotten to see Gondor, though. Again, I saw it was a little less than a year ago that I ran to Minas Tirith in the form of a chicken.
Uh-huh.
So I did get the tour from about 6 inches above the ground of Gondor.
Makes everything look even grander.
Yeah, it really does. It really does. Pelargir looked awesome. From avian form,
mm-hmm.
and then went all the way up and jumped off the pinnacle. Minas Tirith, yeah.
And Mike?
I have sort of been trying to play my character up to a high enough level that I can see the stuff that I helped write. I did finally manage to get into Edoras and see the runes that I helped you do how long ago? 3 years ago or something
years,
like
something
that.
Like that.
Yeah. So that's been fun. I'm sort of a lag on the... I'm not up to the very latest content. I have not made it to Minas Tirith. I almost made it to Minas Tirith, and then a deer killed me. I had avoided...
you tried to run? You tried to
dash? I had avoided hundreds of goblins and monsters and things, and then I just kind of was relaxing and sitting there, and then I look up, and I'm dead because some deer came up and speared me in the butt. So that was...
I'm from Canada. That's accurate.
Yeah, right.
That happens all the time, I believe, yeah. So I have not seen the latest level of content, but what I've been enjoying in LOTRO is the because I'm playing at some of the older levels or going back and finishing up quests. Like I was in Mirkwood last night because I hadn't finished up some quests there. It's been interesting to go back and see the kind of tweaks and improvements that sometimes have been made very quietly that have made it a much more fun game to play, though.
Quietly,
on the other hand,
quietly to the outside world, with a great deal of swearing.
Yes, I'm sure. I was walking around Dol Guldur, and suddenly this like glowy guy with 85,000 hit points wandered up and killed me for no good reason. So he's new. But he has a big bright glow, so I was able to avoid him for the rest of the time.
Oh, the wandering threat?
He's a wandering threat, yeah, yes. Sure, yes. Yeah. There didn't used to be. Well, there were wandering, like, you would seek them out because they had shards. There were wandering, like, elite-level monsters that people would, you know, on the chat all the time say, oh, he's over here, quick, everybody get to, you know, Lorien and kill this bear or something that, went on. So, but now Wandering Threat, yeah, I was like, threat, what the heck is that?
Yeah. I remember seeing one in the outskirts of Dol Guldur 2 and managed to give it a wide berth.
So I shot it.
You shot it? It's probably unwise.
I was just seeing if I could take it. It didn't work.
Probably not, though.
So you're still in you're in Rohan. You're still meeting all the people that we just got around to killing at Pelennor.
I've made it to the Beacon Hills and that area.
Okay. So you're to the Beacon Hills in the Rohan part.
Yes.
Oh, okay.
Yes.
Okay. Yeah. Okay, I was just going to say, the Beacon Hills, the Gondor part was at the very tail end of our Gondor.
No, I need to do Pass of the Dead and get myself through there.
So, like, in the intervening time since we did that stuff, we've obviously done a great deal in developing Gondor and the Battle of Pelennor Fields and so forth. I wanted is there anything in particular that you would be looking for from Pelennor Fields? I can tell you if we did it.
Let's see. Well, the thing that I always enjoy about both exploring the geographical regions and of visiting the moments in the game is always the details from the story that I remember that... that I always look for, you know, when I go in. And in the Battle of Pelennor Field, you know, I would definitely be interested to see what would I be wanting to run around the field looking for in the Battle of Pelennor Field. I mean, obviously the site of Theoden's death and the fight of the Witch King.
Spoiler, we got to that.
Yeah, I figured, dude, that you covered that bit. Yeah. But I would certainly be hunting for the leader, the black serpent leader who was cut down by Theoden. I would is there a hewn in half standard of the black serpent lying on the ground?
I'm trying to remember.
That's one of the things I would look around for.
I'll have to make sure now. That make a note to make
huge
sure.
Staff, check huge, huge staff and bearer and Rodon, right? So I'd a hewn staff I would be looking for, a standard staff.
For me, one of the things that I like most about LOTRO is being able to visualize something clearly that I probably hadn't visualized clearly enough from the books.
Yeah.
And so for me, for thinking of Pelennor Fields, and also, you know, Chris came and spoke to my class, and so I've seen some pictures of Pelennor Fields and seen the of Minas Tirith, is the Ramus Acor, and how that had to play out, like, especially if you're on top of the Tower of Ecthelion and trying to look out and see how it divides up and protects the land. Because the one thing in talking to my students about this is I don't think that they appreciate how foresighted, in more than one way, Denethor was in building that. It was, you know, people make, within the story, like Gandalf almost makes fun of it, and Denethor certainly like sort of puts it down. But like building that wall was an incredibly... it was the only chance they had, sort of, was to try to hold it. If you're going to try to defend Minas Tirith, as they ended up having to do right from the main walls of the city, you've got no crops. You know, you can hold it for great store, long prepared. But,
right.
So I really am looking forward to wandering around those areas and seeing what they're like.
The Ramus was fun to do because we got to do it at various levels of decrepitude as the campaign progressed.
Because there are several different layers of that,
because it's not in the greatest shape even at the outset.
They just kind of slap the last bit of the wall together.
Like,
you know,
like
the mortar's not dry yet.
Right, with this trowel.
And then they just, then Sauron's guys come along and just knock it down with elephants and fire anyway, but possibly elephants on fire. But yeah, the Rammus was there because, of course, they don't really touch on the Rammus in the films at all. It's not there. So it was an interesting thing to try to sort of envision something of that magnitude and incorporating things like the Causeway Gates or the Causeway Forts and all of those things. I think the interesting thing about the Rammus is like just how utterly pointless it turned out to be. I mean, Denethor was doing his best.
Right.
And one of the things I wanted to do with Denethor's arc is show that he's more than just the tomato gobbling cretin that he is in the movies, and then he's actually
that's like line of the day, right? Tomato gobbling cretin.
He's actually one of the unsung heroes of the story. I mean, he comes to a bad end, and things go very bad, very very poorly for him, largely of his own making. Although Sauron kind of plays a role too.
Right. But it's supposed to be a tragedy, right?
Exactly.
When you read the appendices and you realize that, like,
yes,
Denethor and Thorongil, mm-hmm, Aragorn in disguise, had been kind of equally the two great heroes.
Right. Yes.
And also, yes, when you get that Denethor was really, everyone's like, oh, Faramir, you are the spitting, you are exactly like Denethor, and everybody loves Faramir, you're
right,
supposed to, I think, and I don't, I think this is one of these places where Tolkien doesn't quite write it as well as, you could then develop it later on because it's so much off stage. You could see that Denethor was a great man who put in an impossible situation, then did have this weakness in character, like,
yes,
I gotta peek.
Yes.
And then gets daunted.
Well, it's clearly what Faramir could become, might have become. I mean, it's a cautionary tale in that way. But yeah, I mean, it's true. I think people often underestimate the fact that Denethor sort of passed the test better than Saruman did. I mean, both of them were confronted in a sense by the same challenge.
And Denethor never
Denethor
goes
did
evil.
Better.
He's
exactly.
I just want to win. And
we
were talking about that in my class last week when we were doing that material, is that it's despair.
Yes.
And it's wan hope, but it's despair based on something legitimate. And in fact, Tom Shippey and I had this like big, fun argument about this. What is it that Denethor sees in the Palantir?
Yes.
Right?
Yeah.
And I had said it's Sauron holding up the mithril shirt and the sword and saying, ha, I know. Now, it turns out that that's not possible.
Yeah, the timing
doesn't
work.
Because Shagrat can't have gotten to Barad-dûr before the things happen. But what it is clear to me is that Denethor, because when you read about how the Palantir work, he can see anything that's lit, even if it's inside a mountain or something.
Right.
And he's just been told by Faramir they went to Cirith Ungol. He just looked up in the Tower of Cirith Ungol and saw Frodo,
Frodo
with the orcs,
and
he's like, it's over. And that's a legitimate reason for thinking it's over.
Right. Yeah,
he's carrying the ring.
Your
know
hope is but ignorance, he says.
Yeah, you and
Gandalf,
I talked about
right?
that when we were developing the darkest hour, or darkest day timeline, that we really ought to show the thing that besides, oh, look, there's a bunch of Easterlings just like there
always
are.
There's a ship with black sails. Who could have ever predicted that?
Yeah, exactly.
Since we've been at war with Umbar for 200 years.
I wanted to include that shot of Frodo alone in the... He's in there. And that was our...
Yeah.
That was our first little teeny tiny bit of Mordor content. Was the top of the Tower of Cirith Ungol, the one room, and it's I think it really helps drive home not just the tragedy of Denethor, but also how precarious everything is at that point. And it's part of Tolkien's really elegant working of the timing of everything that is actually happening at the point when it's the thing that Denethor is, it's the worst thing for him to see. There's a certain amount of, I guess that's just catastrophe as opposed to the catastrophe that happens a lot, that coincidence just happens to
and,
be.
And what you just said a second ago about how the Rammus does absolutely nothing, I think that plays in and makes Denethor more sympathetic in the sense that one, Denethor saw how big the armies were, but he didn't see kind of how effective they would be. Like all the things hidden in Osgiliath and how they flood across the river at the same time.
Right.
And so he naturally concludes that Sauron has the ring at this point. Like, yeah. they wouldn't be that effective. They wouldn't just be trolls bashing through every wall. We can't stop anything.
Right, yeah.
Unless he also had the ring. And then he goes and checks, and he's like, yep, there's the Hobbit. You know, right.
yeah.
we're done.
Yeah, exactly. So, you know, it's basically all of his worst thoughts coming to fruition. And, you know, that was part of what was behind the Darkest Day storyline that we developed, which was a fun one to do, because it was one of the few times that we've just been able to wantonly say, cast aside the books and let's just do a thing. And, and that was born from, like, I was like, okay, well, when we were starting work on Minas Tirith, there were a bunch of things happening a bunch of problems that were sort of asserting themselves. One was there was no way we could do the entire battle at Minas Tirith and Pelennor in one go. Number one, it would be over too fast for the players. Number two, it would be over too fast for us. So both the siege and the battle were huge undertakings. So, you know, we wanted to split that up over mm-hmm. a couple of updates so we could do them justice. But also, I felt like there was a certain predictability that you know, with the battle that we were running in danger of, because everyone knows how it plays out, and, you know, this is going to be the main thrust of two timelines. So I was tired from putting my kids to bed at home and not really thinking straight, and I thought, I just want to kill Gandalf. And I sort of, you know, the inner voice that normally stifles those thoughts was not there, and I said, that's a terrible thought. Hey, can we do that? And so the whole notion of getting inside Denethor's head, getting to see exactly what it was he was up against, the utter despair, mm-hmm. and do it in game form, and that also allowed us to have an ending to the first half of the battle that wasn't just, and the Black Rider came through and a rooster crowed and that was it. You know, there was an actual climax. It wasn't the climax in the books, but that had the benefit of rocking the players back on their heels as well,
right.
when Gandalf went down.
Well, and I think that ability to explore the counterfactuals and the other side of it is actually something that Tolkien does,
yes.
but very narrowly. Like, you know, when he says, I'm thinking of, like, in The Quest of Erebor, they say, you know, what you would actually have had was fire and swords in Rivendell and no queen in Gondor if we hadn't taken out Smaug
right.
to begin with. And that's, okay, it's a one sentence, but it's a very evocative sentence.
Right.
And then from that kind of idea, you can say, yeah, what happens if Gandalf loses? And it also then, I mean, I say it as a player now rather than as a scholar, it raises the stakes of what you're doing as a player character in a story where you know what the big narrative arc is.
Right,
right.
And where you can't destroy the ring, but yet, like, there's a lot, you know, you had to kind of watch Boromir get killed by the orcs.
Mm-hmm. Right.
You couldn't intervene as a player character. Like,
right,
actually,
yeah.
I stood up on behind a rock and shot them all in the back of the head, and let's go, Boromir, now you're good.
Or, you know, I had the same experience doing the, we cannot get out session play,
yes,
in Moria,
yeah, yeah.
And it fades to black, and I was like, I was actually still doing fine. Like,
we would have got out.
I could have taken him. I could have taken
died.
Him.
Yeah. Yeah.
But then the curtain just comes down, and I'm like, all right, I guess I have to die.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah, I mean, they certainly, like, playing into a lot of the historical stuff, and you know, I love alternate history stuff.
Yeah.
In real world alternate history, so being able to do that, actually have a chance to do that in Middle Earth was a heck of a lot of fun, and it let us it was very helpful after building Minas Tirith for like 4 to 6 months to be able to be like, okay, now set it on fire. Because you get it, placing white columns one after another can be an arduous process at times.
Right, right. Well, you know, one of the things that I really look forward to, and I'm fascinated to hear you talk about how you did, was how you bring together all of the many additional storylines that you've added, right? Because, I mean, obviously, it's one of the things that I enjoy most about LOTRO, is being able to dig into and play and explore the stories that get a sentence or half a sentence in Tolkien, yeah. right? I mean,
the Kingdom of Rudaur.
For instance, exactly, right. You know, and how by the time you're at the end of Volume 1, like, you know the Kingdom of Rudaur inside and out, right? I mean, it's like an old friend by that, and that's really cool. But, for instance, I have loved Volume 3 of the Epic line. Mm-hmm. And getting, like, gathering the Grey Company.
Yeah.
Just the mere fact that, so you met all these rangers in all the different places, right? And then when it comes time to gather together the Grey Company, the Grey Company in the book is Halberd and a bunch of dudes.
Right, yeah, right? Exactly.
I mean, like, literally a bunch of faceless dudes. And faceless, nameless dudes, most of them, until they die and get put in the elegy. And that's the only time we ever know anything of them. But, of course, you know all these guys. You quest with all every single one of these guys. So it's, you know, from the very beginning, not just the story as it develops through Volume 3, but from the very beginning,
and that was
you have all this backstory.
That was a long game we were playing even from the get-go. We were like, okay, well, we were going to, let's keep track of all these rangers that we're making, and the ones that are still alive.
Yeah,
we'll get back to them, and
it is a great feeling when you're playing, and then you come across somebody that, you know, it triggers in, like, well, I don't even know how many years ago I was playing the North Downs for the first time.
Right.
But then when later in Enidwaith or the Grey Company, and I come across, I'm like, I remember you.
You were the one who was sitting by that campfire.
You made me go
spot.
How many stupid quests to kill boars? But there is that sense of. You know, and I think that you get that to a degree in other MMO type play, but it's very distinct and elaborate in LOTRO, because there is that sense of the community of the free peoples, sort of, and everybody knows a part of the story, but not the whole story. Mm-hmm. And I think it works really well. I enjoy it a lot.
When you
see someone that you haven't seen for, you know, literally years of life, you know, versus, or maybe even months of gameplay, it's pretty exciting unless it's Sarah Oakhart.
But yeah, exactly.
Right.
Don't give away spoilers for the next episode.
Died on so many quest arcs.
Yeah.
Protect Sarah Oakhart. No!
Right. Nothing bad will happen, we assure you.
Against her will. But no, but see, but that's only half of it, right? So on the one hand, you've got the Battle of Pelennor Fields, already with totally different stakes, right?
Yeah.
Because we're invested in literally dozens more characters than we were invested in the book, right? But then at the same time, you have all of the other storylines that are happening during the battle.
Right.
I mean, like take for instance, Elfhelm was busy among the siege engines.
Right.
And Grimble, like, well, that sounds like a good story.
Exactly,
I wonder how that went. Right. And so it's, you know, and surely from a gameplay standpoint, I can see, like, well, there's so many. I mean, the narrative sort of follows Theoden right on his charge.
Right.
And then we get, and then we jump to Éomer.
Right.
Right. And we follow Éomer,
and then we join
Aragorn. But even those, it's not like we're getting any. Much tactical detail of what's going on.
And Imrahil's always doing noble, brave, knightly things, but you never know what they are.
He's
always, like, kind of gallops back after having done something great and looks kind of Prince Valiant like. You know.
Exactly.
Look at my shiny Vambrace. She's still alive.
That's right.
That's been one of the things that I really enjoyed the most, is being able to be like, well, who the hell is Harding? Who is, you know, what's Forlong besides the good old fat guy with the big spear? Like, what is their story? And Pelennor sort of created a new challenge for that, because most of them die at Pelennor.
Yes.
And so it was an interesting challenge to make end that many stories on a note that was at least satisfying.
Right.
And, you know, and some of them happened on camera during their battle instances. Some of them happen in the aftermath, or in the, like you mentioned, Grimbold, the whole set of instances that we did for the last update, it takes us into that part of the battle, which is very different, and, you know, you get to see more things like the Variags more up close and see how Grimbold goes down, which is heroically. Course.
Well, and someone in the chat just said, like, and I totally agree with this, is that many, the tears were shed at different points because you have become very invested in these characters that you've done so many quests, even if they were sometimes kill 10 rats quests. They were often there was a lot of as the writers go, you explored a lot of emotional development, you know, and sometimes it was obvious that that's what had to go, and sometimes it was a surprise. I mean, the Goladir arc is a really powerful thing, and then it comes in as instances that you can play and everything else.
Yeah. And you know, the death of Can Dyth, the ranger, was and especially, oh man, like the tear jerking cinematic we get right after Can Dyth's death with like his voiceover, and I'm like, I remember those times in the Lone Lands, man. Like that was, yeah. I mean, it's really effective character building.
It's really interesting.
It raises the stakes of the Battle of Pelennor Field so much more.
And it's interesting from a storytelling perspective. Like, this isn't really a form of storytelling. You know, you get ensemble dramas in TV, like Game of Thrones, Walking Dead, that sort of thing.
Right.
There's a certain amount of that, but their casts are small compared with ours. Even Game of Thrones' cast is small.
Right. Which is saying something. Right.
And to be able to just bring people back and have not just sad moments, but happy moments where you're reunited with characters that have been like friends since when we first turned the game on in 2007.
And so
my question for that, it's also something somebody said in the chat a second ago, where they said, will you create your own story after the ring is destroyed? But I wanted to go the opposite direction of that, is some of my favorite things are when you've done the backstory.
Yeah.
And it seems to me that there's a lot of that can come.
There's so much. It's almost hard to prioritize stuff like that, as far as like when we do get to do things of that nature, because there's so many things that are mentioned in passing in the books and in our story too.
Well, that's what I was thinking much as anything else, is the Aenor Minas Morgul. What's going to go on? We have to see that. That's not to give too many spoilers, people haven't played, but that's a really important part.
And I almost
imagine that there's got to be somehow. I don't really believe that he went to Minas Morgul and took off the king's crown first, because he didn't intend to lose. I think players have to rescue the king's crown,
so that it's
waiting in Rath Dinan. Just a suggestion. I just think that that's. Can you talk a little bit like what fun you've had about going back into the Ring Forges of Eregion, or, the back in time of Isildur at the Blackstone.
I mean, how much fun would it be to do the Disaster of the Gladden Fields?
One I've always wanted to do is the Fall of
Amon Sul. I was just going to say that.
I've never even seen an artwork of the intact. Right.
Would they still have had Celebrimbor's body nailed to a standard and being carried as armies marched up there?
Like the decomposing body of
Celebrimbor. Yeah, I can say it would be kind of old by that point.
Body's decomposed.
and what do they look? Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Right. Yeah. Yeah.
These are the stories we have to. These are the questions we have to ask ourselves around
rate of decomposition of elvish bodies.
Well, I tweeted a while back that I was writing some background specs, and I actually had to write the sentence. And it was a legitimate sentence for work. And now a note about cannibalism. And so these are just like most jobs you don't have to deal with.
Hopefully, if all is going well. Yeah.
Well, who could possibly be cannibalistic in Middle Earth? But
isn't that that's an art whether the orcs actually are cannibalistic?
Yeah, there's that. That's why I made a note
because
about
they just say, "I bet it's orc flesh he feeds you." But
it could be an insult, right? It could be. Yeah, it could be a deadly insult.
They also partake. I'm trying to remember we were talking about the historical
going
stuff.
Going into the backstory.
I mean the I think the backstory, one of the more interesting backstory things is something that we haven't even fully I want to, in an ideal world, address this by going back to the Corsairs and showing some of the history with them and the Thorngil stuff.
The Thorngil story, absolutely.
Is amazing because we just organically from developing these other characters that are that we only meet basically by mentioning their name in Gondor, this whole backstory that we sort of referenced here and there for Thorngil and his buddy, his young buddies back in the day, Forlong and Hirluin, who I sort of envision as the three musketeers of Gondor, you know, going off swashbuckling and going to Umbar and so forth with
Aragorn
Squire, young Imrahil, and poor Denethor having to sit at home playing the violin while he watches his friends play outside.
Oh, I don't know. I think Denethor was like just the, I just killed just as many.
Yeah,
I just killed 37 orcs. Also, yeah. What?
Come on,
right?
Yeah, yeah, that's true. He could definitely be like the poor sap who just
like he just doesn't get the credit for
yeah,
it.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, and then
yeah,
the one that
the cheerleaders didn't go for, but yeah. Yeah, he still did the same stuff.
Yeah, no, I mean, people do talk about wanting to go on to the story after the ring, but I for me, it would be so much better to do. I mean, I'd like to get to the Grey Havens.
Yeah,
but. But, you know, rather than, like, if I had to choose between, you know, let's foray into the Fourth Age in Gondor and let's do some of the backs, I would totally rather do the backstories.
I think there's room for both. I mean, you know, I think obviously we're building up to the big moment. And there, we can't just be like once the thing goes into the thing, that's it, you know,
right,
that
right.
No more forward stories. So
right.
So there's definitely something
just like the words the end,
yes,
come
the
up
end.
And you can't log
then
in
you
anymore.
Go to Grey Havens and then your game uninstalls itself. No,
not a good idea.
We definitely have plans because it's only in game time, it's only about a week away from that it all ends. Of course,
right.
We spent the past 2 years in the space of 36 hours, but still.
Right.
But I mean, there's plenty of other stuff that I would like to get to, both historically and just seeing what's going on even contemporaneously
And I think like talking from like the literary, you know, putting on my professor hat for a second. Right,
we lost the chat.
You're creating something that in a way that hasn't been done before.
Mm-hmm.
It's a really interesting literary artifact, right?
Mm-hmm.
So one of the rules like making a film is that you just can't have too much of it in flashback. Every time someone's like writing their intro, you know, their first screenplay, and they bring it, you have to go through. Okay, too many flashbacks.
Right. Yeah.
Way too many flashbacks. But it's different in the game setting.
Yeah,
right? Because you choose when to go into the flashback as a player. You don't
have
to, oh, that's too distracting right now. I mean, maybe if a flashback was required in the epic quest or something, but even then you're being led to it. And
right.
That, I think, creates like so many more opportunities. And in a sense, like the text of LOTRO is now this enormous paratext of the Lord of the Rings that follows this rule that it can't contradict.
Right.
Undercut, qualitatively different than the, you know, the main text, and yet around that you have so much freedom to explore and to do things. And it's a weird way to say that it's legitimate, because it's within its own form. I mean, is there any other MMO that's like that, that has a gigantic story? I mean, none that I've ever played. I mean, there.
I mean, you know, the Old Republic has its.
Okay,
has
yeah,
its
that's a good comparison.
And you know, but stuff that's, and obviously, you know, WoW and so forth have their thing, but they're their own property, so it's a different.
Right, but
they don't have to
say like
right,
they can
they
just
have
say,
to
hey,
buy,
we
buy.
Have you know, electric poison panda bears or something like that, and they can stick that in.
Yes, yeah, that's true.
I copyright
whereas,
that.
We have to come up with a lore justification for our electric poison panda bears.
Umbar,
Harad. Coming soon,
there's,
yeah, in
gonna, you can play as a Bjornings when they go to Harad. they come as a panda bear. Is that
no.
Okay?
Yeah,
no, that's not.
Could be like one of the costume things that you can get is like a panda skin.
Cosmetic
for your,
panda
for
skin.
Your Bjorning.
Yeah, yeah.
Because that would be kind of awesome, actually.
We should have introduced the war pandas with the when we brought the Easterlings in. That's true.
Ooh.
Now you've started it, Mike. Now people are going to be clamoring for the cosmetic panda skins.
Yes.
Like that's
Thank
totally going to be a thing now. Yeah.
Yeah.
But yeah, I can't think of another like there have been other MMOs based on existing properties, but there've been. There's been none where they've been keeping the story ball in the air for almost 10 years.
Right,
like
to
we
build
have.
This enormous story and to keep it I'll say consistent. I was thinking non-conflicting, and that's really like wimpy, like faculty talk. No, to keep it consistent.
Right.
And also, I think one of the there's a book. Have you read the book on LOTRO stuff? It's called, I think it's called Ring Bearers or something like that. But it's about different things about online, you know, role playing games related to Tolkien.
Yes,
I think it's called Ring Bearers. I have it, and I've read it like 3 years ago because my book that I'm still not finishing has a section on, like, you know, the LOTRO. But what they talk about also is that the overall game has this, in addition to consistency with the lore, there's a, Corey, help me out here, there's a feel to it. There's a, the whole Tolkien community, like, you know, yes, there's kill 10 rats quests,
right.
But there's never like, hey, let's go burn the orphans and the children, you know, or the, like, which you can imagine that George R. R. Martin would put in there just to make, you know, first he would make you care about the orphans and then he would have you kill
playing,
them.
Unless you're
you know?
Playing a creep, but yeah.
That's
yeah.
right.
Yeah, but even yeah. then.
But
I mean,
even that's
like
restricted.
A lot of, there's this Tolkienian ethos that the free people, you never really get rewarded in the quest arc for just indiscriminate
right.
killing
yeah.
or
right.
something.
Right.
Like,
and
that was a
choice from the outset that we wanted.
I think it's worked well though.
Address,
it's
yeah, you know,
with
address
it.
the Tolkien's ethos right. as much as possible.
Well, I mean, even really subtle things like the fact that elves can't target animals and kill.
Wait,
them.
Is that what just came up on the chat? True.
What?
It says if you launch your Bjorning into the Bay of Forichel, it turns into a polar bear.
I would be impressed if that were true.
I don't think so.
Sure,
if it isn't true, it should be true.
I don't think I'm right. No, where were we? No,
sorry.
Okay?
Just kidding. No, I saw it. I'm like, really? A polar bear?
We're talking about the Tolkienian ethos and everything.
Yeah, yeah.
But no, I mean, it's from the beginning, it's the thing that's impressed me more than anything. I mean, it's the fact that LOTRO does both things well. That is, both tell a good and consistent story which parallels the story in the book and interacts with it in really sensitive and interesting ways, as well as maintaining the overall ethos of the world so that when you're not on storyline and just wandering around, that works in lots of different ways, right? Mm-hmm. Not only in the kinds of quests and kinds of stories that you're being involved in and the kinds of peoples and things that you're meeting, but even visually, right?
Mm-hmm.
You know,
yeah,
like,
yeah.
That, you know, it generally the right kinds of ruins in the right kinds of places and things like that. I think it's quite remarkable in those ways as thought of as an adaptation.
Yeah, I still have issues with the Blood Swamp, but...
Yeah,
that
I know.
Was early.
I'm actually trying to come up with. There's a lot of early stuff that's a little okay. I don't know why we did that exactly, but I'm working on a grand unified theory.
You're gonna lore
right
justify.
I will lore
the gaunt men.
If I can lore
the...
justify all of that, then I'll be very happy.
Yeah, actually, the gaunt men, because I just.
I just hate them because they killed me so many times.
Yeah. Oh, well, there's that. Yeah. No, in my kin, we just finished doing the In Their Absence quest line, which was really, we just finished that last week. And so I've been thinking a lot about the Gaunt Men and their relationship with the five wizards. It seems I was kind of struggling with the Gaunt Men in some ways. Are they an early conception?
They are an early conception that, you know, we wanted early on, you know, we were trying to find powerful enemies that weren't the guys that we can't kill. You know,
right.
It can't
right.
just be, we didn't want to overuse right. the Nazgul.
Instead, we got bad guys we could kill many times.
Yes, exactly. but the Gaunt Men were born out of the notion that there were other things that survived the fall of
right.
Of Thangorodrim,
right.
And what could those be? You know, what were Sauron? What were Morgoth's other servants like besides
yes.
the like two or three that were actually introduced to?
Because you and I talked about this like years and years ago. Because once you kind of get out of Moria, it's just orcs, and more orcs.
Mm-hmm.
Like
right.
there's not much. Else that you know
yeah,
the early
not have
part
a monster manual
yeah, yeah. I mean the early part there's you know, you keep getting introduced to new kind of cool monsters
right.
or you know scary trees and
Watcher in the water what the heck is
yeah,
this thing?
Like,
yeah.
The, and that all the stuff in Moria that was off to the side I mean in the book that you guys developed
right
so you had to I mean like what were the bat the Bat People, the Morvilles.
The Morville.
Right.
Yeah.
Yep. And that's in the Grand Unified Theory as well. I've got a whole plan for explaining them, but I don't want to get into it right now.
Yeah.
It
was funny. Somebody pointed out I was in doing my Silmarillion Film Project podcast.
Yeah.
And we were talking about Thorin Gwethil.
Uh-huh.
And I was describing what I was imagining Thorin Gwethil would look like, and one of my listeners called me. He's like, "So essentially a Morvel," and "Darn it, yes,
and
that's exactly what I was thinking."
That is where they came from. We're like, yeah. Let's put vampires in the game, but let's not call them vampires.
Yes.
People are going to expect vampires from
right.
that, and so
right. yeah.
and hence the Morvel, and eventually the Morvul were born.
Right.
You know, all of these things. There was an attempt to either treat them as, oh yeah, well, you know, the bog lurker or whatever, that's just an animal that has, you know, it's a prehistoric animal that is no longer around.
Giant walking fungus.
Yeah, exactly. But a lot of these supernatural things, particularly the ones that are a little bit chimera-like, like the Morvel, you know, we tried to tie those as much as possible to the narrative that we don't actually have access to, but evoke that in a way. You know, Thorin Gwethil can't be in the game, even if she was still around.
Right. Right.
But
that concept
but that
exists
concept
in the
can.
World. Yes.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah. Yeah.
And with where you're going and not saying, there's more opportunities for that, right? Like,
oh,
there
yes.
if the winged Nazgul beasts were found in some eerie somewhere,
right,
and
yeah.
were nourished with fell meats,
yeah, exactly.
and so
right.
forth. I mean, it seems obvious that Sauron's preparing an entire new air force of them that has to be taken out before,
yeah.
you know.
There is so much in so much just hinted at in Mordor, that you know, it's Mordor's almost like the ultimate playground of our notion of like, well, let's take the little hooks that he puts in and build something else.
The vast plantations
yeah.
by
like,
the Sea of Mordor.
Like
the Sea of Mordor, exactly.
Hooks. There's the, because we only really see the places where Frodo Sam
where nothing is going on, which
right.
is why they're deliberately blocked
from
it. Right. right.
Like, so, yeah, if the entire thing is a big empty desert, it was kind of useless to take it over for Sauron.
Yeah, exactly.
So, and they needn't have been so worried when trying to invade.
There are so many blanks to fill in with that. It's
yes.
going to be a fun undertaking when we
absolutely.
Get there.
Absolutely.
You know, and history, too, in Mordor. Like, we don't know what was going on in Mordor pretty much from the time between Sauron getting killed in the first place and then
mm-hmm.
and then coming back at the end of the Third Age. There's this whole, like, 3,000 years of what the heck happened.
Well, and that's one of the things that I know I will be looking for when I get to Mordor. I will be looking at the architecture
mm-hmm.
and trying to figure out what was built by the Numenoreans and
right.
what was built by Sauron
mm-hmm.
and where can we see, you know, the orcs having rebuilt and manipulated the structures that were laid by the Gondorians
mm-hmm.
at first when they and during their occupation.
Yeah.
And I mean you've got
to totally
I would assume
that
there's gonna be you've got a couple chances to do different aesthetics too, because you
yes.
did the
right.
Angmar aesthetic, which had that almost I don't know, almost Victorian, like real steep roof.
Mm-hmm.
Pointy,
yes.
you know,
yes.
and that would, I assume that's like the Witch King's personal architecture
yeah,
design
or
something.
Well, yeah,
and
then
that
yes, the Witch King architect.
And
yes.
then
you know, he has a cocktail napkin. He's like, I want it to look like this.
Yeah.
Right.
More spikes.
More spikes.
Well, and my favorite architectural Angmar point was when you get in, you come near Carn Dûm, and like in the suburbs of Carn Dûm, you have these like. What look like evil Breeland houses,
right?
Oh,
yeah.
Which
hillmen,
presumably are the hillmen,
yeah.
right? Which
right.
are related to the Breemen, right? So
mm-hmm.
these are the hillmen which have been now under the sway of Angmar, so that their houses look a lot like the houses in Bree,
yeah.
except more
except,
evil.
Except evil. Yes.
yes, I loved that.
Yeah, yeah, and you know all of that was intentional. You know, we wanted to. There's been a lot. There's a lot of stuff that we want to draw the links that he only implied.
Yes.
And you know
yes.
that's a prime example. The same as like we wanted Dale to sort of be somewhat evocative of Bree because they're all sort of they all come from sort of the
right.
same northern stock.
Right.
But they've
right.
gone they've diverged quite a bit, and you know and Bree having some similarities with the Dunlendings, with the men of the White Mountains. You know these it's the
And so when you go to southern, the southern eaves of Mirkwood, and where the Rohirrim came from in that area. And then, of course, there's I've been nagging you for 9 years now, the Gladden Fields.
Yes, I know. I know. I won.
The iris, we, the iris gathering people, like they're the florists of Middle Earth.
You know? The ring, the ring. We have to get the ring to the mountain. But we, I mean,
yeah, I know.
One day I have a request in for make me a yellow iris, and I'll just go to town, and then you know, and then we can do the Gladden Fields.
And Saruman's like river dredging operation.
Oh yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Oh man.
Yeah.
And then, oh good, I have to go back to figuring out where all the Nazgul are all the time.
Exactly. Right.
That must have been
tracking,
fun.
Tracking them is fun.
Well, no, they're all circling over Dol Guldur, I just saw.
Yeah, exactly, permanently.
Nazgul traffic control over Dol Guldur, and then they sent out.
That's right.
Yeah.
That's right.
So how are we doing on time?
As long as you guys...
Okay.
Well, what actual time is it?
It's 2:45.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
Okay, cool.
Good for a little bit longer.
So in the spirit of like of the future, once we get past the obvious target that's ahead of us here, like what part of Middle Earth, geographically what part of Middle Earth or culturally what part of Middle Earth would you guys really be excited to see? Because there's still so much.
There is still so much. I'd be really interested in being able to do more up near Dale in the Lonely Mountain.
Mm-hmm.
I haven't done. I'm gonna stream the Road to Erebor instance chain, which I've never done yet.
Okay.
So I'm about. So I'll get to see Dale and Erebor as it's been conceived in those instances.
Right.
I would love to be able to that whole northern.
Yeah,
you
it's definitely something that I would like to get to too, because we're getting to the point where there's very few places described in the books that we still have not built, and things like the Hall of the Elven King. We've all seen the movie version of it, so you know it's a little bit it's different following after again with that, because of most of our stuff that we've done in the Hobbit predated the movies.
Yes.
Yeah, but, and they copied you. I mean, with Goblin. Goblin Town.
Yes, Goblin Town looks a lot like it.
Yeah,
and I mean, I was
parallel
really
evolution. I say
I was really struck by
yes, because of the idea of hanging things from ropes through the middle of a giant cave is completely inherent in the books.
Yeah, yeah.
But so, I would like to. I like the north or the Iron Hills and that area.
Yeah, yeah.
But I just like Ithilien, and heading south along the FL Duath. Because I think that there's so many. One of the things I love about LOTRO is sort of you can kind of play like name that biome, you know?
Yes,
right.
And it's a great the combination of geology and the plant life and the animals that are there, and you know, and then especially when it really really fits well, like in Inidwaith with the killer goats. I love the killer goats and the shadow wolves and things like that. So I am interested in, like, if I just keep heading south along the mountains.
What are you gonna
in
hit
Ithilien,
when you get to get
you know,
because
it's gonna be both
and
beautiful and scary, even higher level monsters and things like that. So and I'm just always interested in ever getting inside either ruins or like the reconstruction of ruins. So I love the ring forges of Eregion.
Yes.
I would like to see the various like lost kingdoms and have that opportunity kind of to toggle into when they when they're not broken and wrecked. So I love Dol Guldur, and even though I just got like I tried to solo a 6-person fellowship thing and it didn't go well.
Right.
But just to go in and see, you know, what the throne rooms would look like, what those sorts of things, like that's why I love Osgiliath. You know, it haven't, and again, just really being running around chased by stuff and not had a chance to play it, but to see that, to go to the spot where the big Palantir, you know, was set, those sorts of things are to me the most fun. I would love to see more, you know, more Eregion, and Amon Sul when it's actually not falling down. And as you said, and also even the stuff that's fallen down, I'd love to wander through the ruins, and when you get a good vantage point, you know, when you can climb up and look down, and that's like some of the most fun.
Enuminous is so much fun in that way.
The whole
Evendim region
area
is
gorgeous.
Is
that was one area where I was really happy that we were finally had the tech to make stuff that's far away up here, really far away in the game, because
right.
being able to see a Numenos across the lake,
that
was just like, that was one of my great heartbreaks, was that we couldn't do that up until we developed that tech.
And so you played the game after they didn't require as much swimming.
That's right. No,
yes.
The boats
like,
had been installed.
Because a lot of the things were like, now swim across the entire lake.
Yes.
You know, so you'd
we
aim it, you'd put
around.
Lock it, and, you know,
yeah.
and then go and, like, you know, eat dinner or something and come back. And you're still, you know, at least nothing came out of the water and ate you. Because
yeah.
that was,
yeah.
I would have wanted to kill. So, I mean, that's one thing about the game is it really has a lot of facets of it. It's kind of like you can be like, well, back when I played, you know,
yes,
where the little
yeah.
glowy things were really little glowy things.
Yes.
Like there
yeah.
was a couple times you had to find Bilbo's buttons, and
right.
it was like one pixel on the screen, Chris. One
right.
pixel. And you're looking around, where's the glowing button? Now it's like, you know, got a firework coming out of it, you can find it. But
we were training you for finding the close ad icon on your phone.
there it is, one pixel there.
Yeah.
And so that you know, that's improved. But it also, it made it, I mean, I told the story multiple times about being killed by bears
right.
so many times. The stupid black, I went back and killed it in the Shire, just like, the one level 6 elite.
So yes. that's an example of completely cleaving to the Tolkien ethos, vengeance killing
yes, walk
bear.
All the way back to the Shire and
yes.
kill that bear with
yeah.
one shot. So I'd be like, Nithruk, the stupid goblin, I hated that thing too.
Yeah.
Someone said some giant turtle was out there waiting to eat me. Well, there is the lake full
there,
of evil turtles.
We do have, yeah, we did do evil turtles a few
well,
times.
Well, and of course there is a giant turtle. It's
yes.
just not, doesn't attack, it doesn't come out of the lake and attack you.
No, no.
Wait, which?
In the Tomb of Lendon.
Oh, yes,
yes.
Oh, I thought
yeah.
you meant like in the
no,
lore.
No, no, yeah, yeah. yeah.
Oh, I don't
no,
even
no.
know if the word turtle appears
not,
in the
not
entire
in the
Lord of the
Rings. Not in the lore, no.
That's a good question.
No, the only turtle I can think of in all of Tolkien is Fastatakalon in the poem, in
yeah.
the revised poem.
And you know that Fastatakalon might have been the thing that we were like, well, that's the
giant turtle. There it is.
Yeah.
There it is. Yeah. We're talking about, by the way, the poem that's in the Adventures of Tom Bombadil called
yes.
Fastatakalon. Just in case you don't know what we're referring to.
Yeah. There's so much in there that you know, it's one of the things that we try to do is we try to put little references to other stuff in the game,
right.
including not just Tolkien but his influences. The Battle of Maldon when Hama the Door Warden goes down
mm-hmm.
in
the spirit must be stronger
must,
that,
yeah that we try you know that was your suggestion that we throw that bit in to drive his death home because
and then
that's another one of those off camera things that like
yes.
it amazed me when I was reading the books that
they hewed Hama's
actually,
body before the gate as he fell. And
yeah,
that's pretty
that's
much
right.
all he says.
Yeah,
that's
right.
Like, way after
the crying his eyes out
way
about
after,
it.
Exactly.
You know,
we were at the battle of the chapter ago. Why didn't you describe that then? So,
yeah.
you know, but it gave us the opportunity to do it, to do our own take on it that we might not have been able to do otherwise.
Yeah.
Someone just
yeah.
said the Roverandom stuff in Even
Dim.
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah. Yes. Yeah. The missing dog. Yeah.
Yes. Yeah. yeah. And, you know, everything right down to meeting the Inklings at the Burton baby.
And the rabbit.
And
in the
rabbit.
Room,
yeah.
Yeah.
The,
yeah.
And the rabbit that's outside of the killer rabbit outside the fortress.
Yeah.
That which is not
yeah,
quite Tolkien
much,
canon.
Pretty,
but
it's pretty much
canon.
Required by law.
Yeah.
To
yeah.
have a killer rabbit somewhere.
But
exactly.
I was thinking of
yeah.
that. I think it's Nantarn or something like that. You've got this in the Lonelands, or at least you used to. I haven't been out there in a very long
mm-hmm.
time in this part of it. Up above the big, the cool waterfall that's in the Lonelands,
mm-hmm.
you have. Like this lake that was clearly Tolkien or Christopher drew it in there to fill in a blank spot on the map.
Yeah, yeah.
And all it has is like turtles in it. There's no quests. There's yeah. really nothing to do. You know, you see it on the map. You fight your way all the way over to that lake, and it's like
what's
you
awesome?
Can kill snapping turtles for 45 minutes and you know get a Slayer deed done or something like that.
Yeah.
But I think that you kind of have to have that. Like every single piece
well,
of landscape
yeah.
can't be part of the major story arc.
Yeah,
you know?
It's hard enough to fill it as it is. That's why when like people complain that, oh well, I wish it would actually take. A month to travel from Greed. No, you don't.
How many trees?
And we don't want
how
that.
How many trees?
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's
yeah.
For you, like you would. There would literally be days of just seeing moors going by. And you know,
there's a Goldilocks and the Three Bears house.
Yes, there is. There is, and and then these references. I think all of us are actually in the game somewhere. Like,
oh yeah,
because. I have to make so many names for things in the game that a lot of the time I pull from from things in my life or things that I enjoy and you know, just people's names that I know and translate them into Rohirric or Sindarin. And I think I know at one point I did all the noble houses of Minas Tirith, and I know that like Tom Shippey has an equivalent in there, and Vernon Flieger
has one in there.
And I'm pretty sure there's a House Olsen and a House Drought in there somewhere, yeah. But I can't for the life of me.
Oh, now I have to go explore the whole thing. That's
not
awesome.
Not actually called that is the thing. So I had to look up what your names mean.
That makes me very happy. Yeah. I don't know if I ever told you this story about from way back when, like it probably was in 2009 or 2010. My kids were little. And I'd been playing LOTRO research. It was research then.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know, and I was playing it. And so I got two stories. The first is I'd let them sit beside me, you know, and play. And this was back before there was automatic looting, right? So you'd have to click on something.
Right.
So, you know, you'd kill something and its body be there, like, loot it, loot it. So that Christmas, we're driving to go to somebody's house for dinner. And there's a dead squirrel on the road. I'm like, oh, look, a dead squirrel. And my wife, who had been making fun of us, goes, loot it, loot it. So, that was the first thing. But the second was that they when my kids were, I think they were like maybe 8 and 4 or something, they would play baby warg, mama warg. And they'd be crawling around the house, like woofing and growling and stuff. Mm-hmm. And so at one point they were playing this game, and I'm like, oh, so, okay, you're deadly wargs. What are your names? Like, you know, blood drinker and bone chewer? And my daughter goes, my name's Patches.
Patches.
And my son goes, I'm Cookie.
Yeah.
So I think that you need wandering, like,
that's
you know,
right.
Level 1,000 wargs named Patches and Cookie.
I'm going to translate Patches and Cookie into black speech when I get back to the desk, and they will turn up.
It was so, like, perfectly unexpected.
I'm sure there must be a black speech word for Cookie, right? I mean, there's got to be something in the corners for that.
And Patches, yeah, you could, you know, Shagrat probably close.
Yeah, probably.
Or, you know, whatever the heck his name means.
Oh yeah, there was people on the chat mentioned that you're actually in it twice because there's Druid there's a guy named Druid who's a Rohirrim in the Stone of Wirgenda.
Oh, okay.
Which is another thing that you know you were
you
very
had me translate into.
So I felt like I had to get you.
Oh
in there
man,
you did so much translation work for that and for Rohan in general.
Then we got the word Richtfaderenkin into
and the other one, Ellen Fremadon. In there because of you as well.
That's a scholar. Do you know Jill Frederick?
No, I don't.
Okay,
I don't.
She's an Anglo-Saxonist in Minnesota, a small school in Minnesota, and the big medievalist conference at Kalamazoo, there's a midnight dance, which is just as terrifying as it sounds.
Absolutely.
Of medievalists having a midnight dance, but she always used to wear on her name tag, hello, my name is Ellen Fremadon, which is the line from Beowulf. So I love it. I have to email her and tell her that her, because that way if someone tried to pick her up, like, hey, Ellen. And she's like,
yeah.
yes. And it's true. It's always one of the most formative and horrifying experiences as a medieval graduate student to go to Kalamazoo and see all of the famous scholars whose works you've been reading
trying to dance.
Dancing drunk at the conference. It's mm-hmm. really quite
really,
something.
I mean, if you need to, like, for something in Minas Morgul, I would go and just, you know. It looks like a Hieronymus Bosch painting. It really does.
Right.
Oh,
and I'm making fun of myself here, too. Like, you know, no one wants to see that. I mean, you can't say exactly where it's going, except everyone knows
I'm not sure if I'm at liberty to say
where it's going. But on the way to where it's going,
yeah.
Will there be more in Osgiliath?
Will there be
straggler clearing and you know
yeah, we
advanced
did, we
scout
just,
work?
We just released North Ophelion.
Oh, I haven't
and
tried.
A
okay,
great deal of that and. Dealing with the Easterlings who are trying to mess you up on the way, and the faint-hearted in Chirandros, and all of that.
That goes up to, but not including the battle before the Black Gate.
We cut it off at the edge of where all the everything starts to get really bad.
Okay,
and then,
where the horror
so
affects
we're,
the men of the East.
We're forming up, and
we're
on the hills.
Yeah, so right. we do give people a nice glimpse of the Black Gate during one instance in the last update, and we're gonna get the rest of the way there soon.
Yeah. Okay. Do you do?
Well, then you're going to have to fork and then go. Right. I mean, it's more well, Valkyrith Ungol. So go from inside.
There's a plan. There's
okay.
A plan.
I'm sure
that
there
is a plan, and I'm trying not to ask about it.
Yeah.
You
blew up the bridge a bit to meet us, Morgul. So you can't go that way right now. Anyway.
Right.
You don't want to swim that thing.
Right.
Oh,
exactly.
Is it like Angmar water?
Yeah. Well, it's Angmar-ish. It's Morgul water.
Touch it and die.
Yeah,
though, is it? I remember the first time I touched the green water and just boom, fell over dead.
Yes.
Like,
it was pretty obvious. You know,
now, you do get to you do get Henethanun, right, in the latest update?
Yes.
Sorry, yeah.
Yes, Henethanun was fun because I realized that, you know, most of our dungeons obviously are their own separate spaces, but Henethanun is so integrated with the landscape and being able to look out across toward the Anduin through the waterfall and that we actually, you know, it's like, okay, well, we always do a difficult thing every time. Let's make a giant cave complex that actually sits flush in the landscape and makes sense within the lore.
Right.
And I'll tell you, trying to figure out, Henethanun is one of those ones where trying to get the lay of the land for it from the text.
Yeah.
Right.
Especially because everyone's blindfolded.
When you're blindfolded.
The
and the Forbidden Pool
is somehow
like sort of out the front, right? Because the moon is coming through it where the sun was coming through.
Right.
But
there's
they
an
don't really describe
down.
Seeing
yeah.
a Forbidden Pool when they. Are there
exactly.
the first
well, yeah,
time?
Because they, well, because he's got the got the blindfolds
mm-hmm.
on at that point. So
but I mean, even when they look out and the window of the west, and it's like, and down below was.
Yeah, well, I guess they just never look down. I don't know. Mm-hmm. But they, yeah, the you know, just figuring that out and then figuring out a way to make it all work on the landscape.
Was
interesting because we were essentially sculpting negative space, which is. You know, that's a challenge. That's not a thing that I thought I would do with my life. But yeah, it's been and stuff like Henethanun. It's been fun to try to like push it and figure out, you know, how to get it right for the books in ways that we might not have been able to do 10 years ago when we first started.
Right.
You know, and it being able to achieve all sorts of stuff that no one's really bothered with all that much, like. Saruman's robes changing colors all the time. It's like they kind of thank God Peter Jackson didn't do that because that would have been seriously distracting in the movies. But you know all the weird little details that he throws in that you know oftentimes he doesn't even really explain what they're about.
Right.
Well, that's what I thought that when you guys came up with the Shadow Wolves,
mm-hmm.
like that kind of.
Yes.
Blur.
Yes.
That's got so much potential.
Yes.
I mean, you don't want to overuse it, but it works so well. For those. What I guess you know if we're running out of time, I had a question about artifacts.
Okay.
So have you felt that it was okay? I was kind of surprised that we didn't have sort of artifact explosion, right? So we have within the weapon systems and stuff. You have
mm-hmm.
you know first age, second age, legendary, relic, this and that.
Right.
But overall, you know, there's so many compared to all previous fantasy stuff. There's so many artifacts in Tolkien with LSR and. File of Galadriel and this and this, but you guys haven't done that. Like you know, it's been get a Palantir that's been lost, or go
you mean,
to
like,
see Arvidway.
On the subject of forging new stuff,
like you haven't done that. And,
and part of that is like there's a sense in Tolkien that all the really cool stuff was kind of made in the past. Andúril, not you know, Andúril even is a.
Mm-hmm.
You know, reforging of something, but you know, it's the swords of Westerness are something from the past, and the even theoretically the cloak brooches are you know that's secret elvish stuff. You know, there isn't really as much of a moment in the books where the hero goes out and forges his sword. You know, except you know Andúril.
But you theoretically have that option to say, oh, you know what, have a big long quest chain to get the some kind of magical additional artifact, which would be very much like with like WoW or something like that.
With the Silithar,
that's the only one I can think of, and it works really well because how else are you going
to
reforge that? Oh well, those smiths were just hanging out there and they were good.
To an extent, we found that the people in Middle Earth are more interesting for dealing with than the things all the time, because they are. You know, people, the players are more likely to get attached to them. They're attached to the ones from the books. Would I, you know, would, should we throw more? Throw more?
No, I don't think you should. I just think it's interesting that you've resisted that because there are in other kind of MMO or fantasy things, it's always about we're going to have a ranked system of color coded. Magic swords.
That's exactly
that you can
why
follow.
We didn't want to do it. Is right. We didn't want to overdo the. We didn't want to lose the wonder.
You become
of the
Anne
things.
McCaffrey, and I like Anne McCaffrey, but everything is color coded and ranked
right.
with green
right.
at the bottom and bronze.
And that's why
that
was actually legendary items was a way to try to address the we want the players to have a cool thing, but we don't want it to just be like, pull the handle, get a a book of vile darkness or something. Want people to have more of an attachment to their artifacts.
I wish I understood the legendary system enough to
that. I know.
I just recently got an excellent tutorial on it, so I'm finally.
It's fun. It's definitely an advanced feature. It's one of those things that once you get the hang of it,
I love that I made one of my key artifact runes as a cook. I'm just picturing I have my amazing bow and it's got a muffin stuck in it.
That's right.
I totally get why the system works. And obviously it didn't look stupid, but it was just. right. But no, I think that's
Madman
really...
Madman Motto over there is the guy who gave me my tutorial. So that's why he put the smiley face up there. Yeah.
Well, I'm just glad that you have kind of resisted that, the kind of cheapening of the whole thing and because it's so easy otherwise. And within it, when it's in the legendary system or something, it's not like... I mean, if you really started to think it through, that we're ransacking every tomb and wandering orc to get fragments of relics to melt down to make other relics and stuff like that. But that's just a game mechanic. I mean, in terms of undoing the whole how amazing Narsil is.
Yeah, exactly.
Or, Andril, you're not really undoing that, I don't think.
That was the approaching magic and such in Tolkien is such a thorny thing as compared with the general zeitgeist of modern fantasy that it pays to be to be sparing with that sort of stuff because it really is part of the world that magic's special and
Gergai Naji argued that there I think he's ends up being not quite right but he's like there's really isn't actually any magic at all, there's just technology that you don't understand. I don't think that quite works. With the opening doors and the ring and Gandalf's ring explains a lot of stuff that he can do, but there's other places that I just don't think you can finesse it, that it's just technology.
I mean, it's a way to think about it, but I'm not sure that's in the end a useful way to think about all of it.
If you think of just technology as a general term for things that are made, then
exactly. Or things that
it's freighted with other meanings, so it becomes...
Exactly.
And there's stuff that just happens sort of magically. I don't know how you would, say.
Yeah.
In other words, you can discount a fair bit of it because Elrond and Galadriel and Gandalf have rings.
Right.
And they're doing stuff, and you can say, okay, that's technology. And you can get the door opening and, the stuff like that. It's got a voice activated, and they just don't understand.
Right.
But there's enough pieces.
And Sting can detect orc pheromones that are the
that's right,
all
yes.
way
it's,
to
it's,
rock.
It's,
like,
exactly.
And to me, the most magical thing is that after about, what is it, between the fall of Gondolin and the events of The Hobbit is at least 7,000 years?
Yes.
That the goblins can still instantly recognize which
it.
Sword is
and they know
which.
It by name.
Either they're reading the runes or they have this amazing goblin educational system that is passed down.
That's
right.
See these, run.
That's right.
Yeah.
Can you imagine a little goblin classroom with it on the wall? Like someone with a little pointing stick saying, beater, biter, other glowy swords that you should run from.
That's right. And thanks for that, by the way. I think the phrase orc pheromone is going to haunt me all week now. Yeah, so that's
that. I'm sure they need pheromones. I imagine just a regular stench.
It's in the handle. You know.
Exactly.
So, we're past... Oh, we're nicely past 3 o'clock now, so I think it's
I'm gonna have
probably
to go pick up my children and take them to the orthodontists. Going from the sublime to the opposite of sublime.
Excellent.
We got that coming up too, so that's fun.
Just take a shop vac, put it in your wallet, and turn it on.
That's right.
So well, thanks for coming by again, guys, and we'll try do the next one in less than a year and a half or however long.
Excellent.
It was,
very good. Thanks for having us.
Thanks very much.
Thanks. It's really, and I'm looking forward to seeing.
Thanks
to
everyone.
Next stuff.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, absolutely. And thanks to everyone for tuning in. And I guess we're done.
Very good. Thanks, everybody.
Thanks.
How do you get through the newscaster stare for about 10 minutes?
That's right.